A'udhu billahi min shaitan rajeem. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Jazakumullah khair for coming. Welcome to Ilm Academy. Inshallah, today is a special session we have arranged with the Zaytuna Institute and Sheikh Abdullah bin Hamid Ali. He's from Zaytuna Institute. Just to give you some special introduction about our guest speaker, he's a full-time faculty member specialized in Islamic law, theology, and hadith in Zaytuna College, Berkeley, California. He's a lifetime student of Islamic knowledge, born Muslim, and spent all of his life learning about different aspects of Islamic education from here and abroad. So I want to welcome Sheikh to, inshallah, begin the program. And
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم زدنا ولا تنقصنا وأكرمنا ولا تهنا وأعطنا ولا تحرمنا ولا أثرنا ولا تؤثر علينا وارض عنا ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Alhamdulillah, it's a special honor to be here with you tonight to exchange some wisdom with you from our tradition and also with relationship to our reality that we live in today. Today I've been asked to speak on the topic of Islamophobia in parenting and the connection and the challenges of parenting in the context of what we call Islamophobia today. Now we know that Islamophobia is a word which fundamentally means an irrational fear of Islam and Muslims. In another sense, Islamophobia is another way of saying anti-Muslim racism, which actually is the term that I personally prefer because of the special context of America. And when we reflect upon its history and reflect upon its current reality with regard to the makeup of the attackers of those who are victimizing Muslims and those who are typically victimized, oftentimes people who are victimized are not even Muslims, but they are perceived as being Muslim. And that is because the word Muslim in America is a racialized term. It doesn't simply mean somebody who believes in a certain religion, which we call Islam. That particular religion, most people don't even know much about it, as we know. Rather, a Muslim, when the word is mentioned, a certain image appears in the minds of many people, and so people are attacked on the basis of the way that they look. For that reason, when I speak about Islamophobia, I like to make this point. Now, naturally, there are a number of challenges that come with this particular topic and this particular phenomenon that we're witnessing today as Muslims and the struggles that come along with it, especially in light of the current political situation with these demagogues, especially in the Republican Party right now, calling for very drastic measures against Muslims. And in particular, when they speak of Muslims, they're largely talking about Muslims who recently came from over there and they came here. Master Yoda, you all know Master Yoda, right? Who doesn't know Master Yoda? Anybody know Master Yoda? You know Master Yoda? Anybody ever see Star Wars? So you know Star Wars, right? It's a little tiny guy, it's a big pointy ears, green guy. He's a guy full of wisdom. And of course we know this is an imaginary character, but the person who created Yoda created along with him a number of aphorisms or wisdoms that come along with it. And one of those wisdoms that I believe is extremely important one to highlight is when he said that fear is the path to the dark side. Fear is a path to the dark side. He said, fear leads to anger. Anger leads to hate. And hate leads to suffering. And this is fundamentally the state that we find many people in the United States. Many of these people we say are afraid of Muslims, who are afraid of Islam. And for many people, it is an irrational level of fear. But for some people, it's a rational fear because there are Muslims, as we know, who confirm or corroborate the narrative of people like the Glenn Becks and the Sean Hannitys and all the other Islamophobes out there, which basically emphasize this idea that there is a fundamental problem with Islam as a religion, and that Islam as a religion has to be abolished, it has to be outlawed, it has to be destroyed. So these many people who have this perspective, and some to some degree, they have a rational fear of Islam. On the other hand, there are many people who hate Muslims not because of a fear of Islam, rather is because of something with them. And this is something we have to contend with as well, because we have to be careful when we utilize the term Islamophobia, that we are not making excuses for people's violence. You know, we say, okay, well, the person, he killed my wife, but he had Islamophobia. You know, so don't send him to jail, send him to the hospital, right? No. People know exactly what they're doing. They know that violence is wrong. They know there's evil. And we have to be careful that we don't take it to an extreme when we start talking about Islamophobia. It's phobia such that we give an excuse for people to do what they do. Now, of course, the challenges that we have as parents are manifold in this current environment of fear and hate, hate mongering. Among those fears is the protection of our own lives, the preservation of our wealth and our well-being, our bodily integrity, the protection of our children, the sense of safety that we have about being in a place where we had hope that we would be able to live a better life. And so when people start talking about sending Muslims away, then that in itself is become a great significant source of anxiety. It's not something that I personally deal with on a regular basis, because this is my home, and I personally, as a Muslim, African American Muslim, whose roots, as far as back as I can remember, which is not very far, you know, are here, and we know that, of course, we're somewhere in Africa. Some of my ancestors came from, but I do understand that for many of you, that this is a very real issue, and really is terrifying for many people. You know, but we have the challenge of making sure that our children stay out of harm's way, both from being radicalized by crazy Muslims, but then also being radicalized by law enforcement, because what we do know is that most of the cases in our particular context, we find that most cases where we find alleged plots of terrorism which have been thwarted by law enforcement, realistically were created by law enforcement to begin with. And so for that reason, we have in our masajid, in our institutions, people from law enforcement who oftentimes have a bad intention about the community. And our children have to be taught how to be careful about what they say, careful about their opinions that they express, careful about the type of websites they visit on the internet, the type of things they post on the internet. All those different things are extremely important, because though it can be very incriminating types of things and become causes for members of law enforcement who are already watching the Muslim community very closely, but not watching other communities are actually here proven to be more violent than Muslims, much significantly more violent than Muslims, you know, that they're already watching us and trying to find a justification to validate their budgets, right? Their homeland security budgets, among other things. So these are things to consider. We have to be very careful about this, both for our sons and our daughters, and then also as one another. And we need to be very alert to the fact that oftentimes when we find this particular element of law enforcement that may come into our space when they are trying to manipulate and entrap people, that they generally target people, one, who are in trouble with the law, and then two, people who perhaps don't have citizenship, you know, and so they come to them and approach those type of people, and they put pressure on them and say, well, if you don't help us, then we're going to send you back wherever you came from. If you don't help us, we're going to put you in prison for 10, 20 years for this crime that you just committed. Those are the most vulnerable targets of those type of practices, you know. And so, and this is something that is the reality, you know, we have to deal with it. And though people may say, no, we don't profile. Yes, they do. That's the way that law enforcement works. I used to work in the prison system. So I know that by being close to law enforcement, that profiling is something that comes with the territory that you realistically can't do authentic or effective law enforcement without profiling of some sort. Just that you can't make it a public policy, that's what you do. So those are some things to consider. And with regard to trying to offer some guidance on some things that we can do on a regular basis to strengthen the minds and the will of our children and even of ourselves, I think we need to reflect upon our natures as human beings. That in education, and that's one thing that's beautiful about Islamic education, that Islamic education not only considers trying to make our students successful in this world and prepare them for the challenges of this life, but we're also concerned about preparing them for the challenges of the next life. That is one thing that is special about our education. That is about deen and dunya. Not just dunya, but deen as well. And we are a psychosomatic creature. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us as both flesh and spirit. And he's made it such that things that we do with the flesh, they can impact and weaken the spirit, or they can strengthen the spirit, and vice versa. Some things that we do to the spirit can strengthen or weaken the flesh as well, or weaken our control over our bodies. And those are two things that we need to remind ourselves of. You know, the person, the human being, is called hayawan natiq, an articulate animal. Because we're both, so we're an animal in one sense, but also we are rational in the other. And this is fundamentally one of the messages of the Quran with regard to the story of Adam alayhi salam, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him, and he said, "Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa," that will place a vicegerent in the earth, a steward for the earth. And the angels responded, "Ataj'alu fiha man yufsidu fiha wa yasfiku ad-dima'?" Are you going to place therein one who will spread corruption and will shed blood? وَنَحْنُ نَسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. And Allah says, قَالَ إِنِّي عَلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah says, I know what you don't know. And so as if that the angels, they looked at the animalistic aspect of the human being and saw that how we can be manipulated by our desires, our passions, our appetites. And they saw and realized that the human being, you know, if that is left and goes unchecked, then the human being will not be a fit to steward the earth, not fit to manage and regulate justice on this planet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I know what you don't know. And then after this, he said, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. And then he taught Adam all the names. ثُمَّ عَرَضَهُمْ عَلَى الْمَلَائِكَةِ. And then he presented them to the angels. What's the significance of that? The significance of this is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as if he says to the angel, yes, you have a point. But there is something you're missing about this creature. This creature has an ability. It has a strength. It has a faculty that other creatures do not have. And that particular faculty, that capacity, is what we call rationality. So teaching Adam the names, this is really where rationality begins. Rationality, we are first thinkers before we are speakers, to begin with. That human being is a thinker before he or she is a speaker. We see it in babies. Babies can't talk, but they understand quite a bit. But in communication, we ourselves, in order to perceive our worlds, we give things names. And we set boundaries to things. We place label on things. And then through that, more and more thought it develops. And rationality pretty much becomes much more complex. Now, the mistake that the human being has made historically is not so much that we put labels on things and we name things, we designate things. Rather, the problem historically that we've had is that we have misdesignated, or we have given things, mislabeled things, right? And that is to say that we not only place things in convenient categories, rather we actually qualify them too. We start to say, you know what, this is not only a woman, but this woman is less important than the man, right? That men are more important than women. So once we start to move from the designation to now evaluating things and giving them certain grades, right? The black is not important as the white. The non-Arab is not important as the Arab, right? Right? So that's where we've always gone wrong historically. And I would end just to mention some verses in relationship to some advice that Luqman al-Hakim is related to have given his son in the Quran, because we have to teach our children about their natures, about who they are, what they are, right? And also emphasizing that the flesh should not have mastery over the mind, right? That the soul or the mind, the heart should have mastery over the flesh, even though it becomes difficult because we begin our lives and the flesh first gains mastery over ourselves, you know, but the rest of our lives, once we become adults, so we enter into adulthood, the rest of our lives is spent attempting to gain mastery over the flesh. You know, so if we have mastery over the flesh, then it's less difficult for us to be manipulated. It's less difficult for us to be seduced by ideas that are deviant ideas, ideas that are radical, right? Right. If we have more control over the nafs, over our appetites, you know, we can only have more control over them if we increase our knowledge, we educate ourselves, we contribute to the growth, the spiritual and intellectual growth of ourselves. But we see in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasizes some things and he talks about what Luqman says to his son. وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانَ لِابْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعِذُهُ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. He said to him, he said, and remember or mention when Luqman said to his son, dear son, يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ, do not ascribe partners to Allah. Do not worship Allah with other things. For verily, idolatry is a grave injustice. It's a grave injustice. So it's the first thing. So it's like the importance of knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is one thing I mentioned in the khutbah today, that these five things I think are extremely important in this battlefield we call it the earth, we call it battlefield of the dunya, right? The lower life, that you need to know yourself. Of course, you need to know God first. You need to know yourself. You need to know your purpose. You need to know your reality, and you also need to know something about the cosmic order. And so when it comes to this issue of knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the very first thing that Allah mentions, that Luqman said to his son, don't ascribe partners to God. Very first thing. Don't worship anything other than Allah. Do not attribute divinity to anything other than Creator. Not in knowledge, not in stature, not in power, not in anything. Do not ascribe anything to that. If you do so, know that it is a grave injustice, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who is worthy of your worship because of all that He has given to you. And then the following advice or admonition or counsel that He gives to him is that, يَا بُنَيَّ إِن تَكُ مِثْقَالَ حَبَّةٍ مِّنْ خَرْدَلٍ فَتَكُنْ فِي صَخْرَةٍ أَوْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ أَوْ فِي الْأَرْضِ يَأْتِي بِهَا اللَّهِ. So he said, "Oh son, dear son, even if it happens to be a mustard seed, which happens to be in a boulder or on a boulder, or it is found in the heavens or on the earth, Allah will bring it forth. Allah will bring it to light." That is to say that realistically, why believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you don't believe in judgment? If you don't believe in an afterlife, what's really the benefit of that? I believe in, some people just believe in God, that's it. They don't believe anything after life, after this life. Why believe if you don't believe in accountability? So be aware of who your Lord is, but then also remember the power of your Lord, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? That regardless of how small the thing may be, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring it forth. وَمَنْ يَعْمَ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ. Whoever does an atom's weight of good will see it. وَمَنْ يَعْمَ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ. And whoever does an atom's weight of evil will see it. And then he follows us up and he says, يَا بُنَيَّ أَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ وَأْمُرْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَانْهَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكَ. And he said, "Oh, dear son, establish the prayer. Establish the prayer, enjoin what is good, forbid what is wrong, and bear the afflictions that come to you with patience." وَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا أَصَابَكَ. And so here it is talking about purpose. What is our purpose? Our purpose is عِبَادَة وَخِدْمَة, worship and service. That in Islam, that we not only, it's not only a private affair, it's also a public affair. That if you're only concerned with yourself, then you're not doing Islam. Right, Allah does not allow for that. He won't allow for it. You know, that He was not going to allow for you to call yourself a believer, a Muslim, without you attempting to take the message to other people, without attempting to help improve other people's lives. And so that's what enjoining good and forbidding wrong is all about. And then when you do so, of course, certain hardships will occur. So be patient. Endure the hardship when it happens, right? So when we have tribulation, we have trials, that we have to remember, understand is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that through tribulation, Allah redeems people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings out the good from the bad. He exposes the true and honest believer from the one who is not true and honest, right? So you can't just be a selfish believer. So establish your prayer, enjoin what is good, forbid what is wrong, and be patient with what afflicts you. Inna dhalika min azmin umur. Wa la tus'ir khaddaka lin-nasi wa la tamshi fil ardi maraha. And do not turn your cheek up and away from people. That is say, don't look at people with arrogance. Wa la tamshi fil ardi maraha, and don't walk in the earth with conceit. And then after this, he finally says to him, "Waqsid fi mashika waghdud min sawtik." He said, "And be moderate in your walk, in your pace, and lower your voice. For inna ankar aswati la sawtul hamir, because the most offensive and the most bothersome of sounds is the braying of donkeys, for lack of a better or less offensive term, you know." But here, this is the advice that Luqman had given to his son. So this is something we can refer back to as Muslims when we start thinking about how do we advise our children on times of tribulation. We go to the stories of the Quran, we look at the examples from the Sunnah like this, and hopefully Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect us and give us the ability to prepare our children for these type of times. But understand something too, is that there's no such thing as you doing everything to make or create the perfect family. Perfect family doesn't exist. It doesn't exist. You know, and if there was a perfect family, then we would have seen it amongst the prophets, alayhim salatu wasalam, and all of them were tried by their families. They were tried by their children. They were tried by their spouses. We see that throughout Islamic history. So we bear patience with them, and we try to protect them from harm, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to suffice us from those who mean us harm. Wa subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. So I don't know what the next order of business is. The brother Iman did mention something about a few questions perhaps, but I don't know, maybe you want to go straight to the Zaytuna College presentation. Sure. Right. Okay, bismillah. Inshallah, before we watch the video, basically I just want to reintroduce myself. I'm Saad Abdullah Adi. I've been teaching at Zaytuna College since 2007. And actually 2007, Zaytuna was still called Zaytuna Institute. And I know some of you remember Zaytuna Institute, but Zaytuna stopped being Zaytuna Institute since about 2010 when we changed our name and we became a college, officially a college, and started our first cohort. I initially started at Zaytuna, teaching at the seminary program, and then went on to continue to help in preparing Zaytuna to start off as college. Alhamdulillah, we have Brother Mahdi here as one of our graduates, one of our first graduates from Zaytuna College. I currently teach the high upper tier Islamic law courses like family law, inheritance law, commercial law, usul al-fiqh and hadith. And Zaytuna is a 4-year college which when the students graduate, they graduate with a degree in Islamic law and theology. And law and theology are extremely important disciplines in every civilization. As a matter of fact, there have been three important disciplines that pretty much spread in almost every historical civilization. One is theology, one is law, and the other is medicine. And so Zaytuna has dedicated itself to ensuring that students have a very firm grasp of Islamic law and theology. But we also say that we're a liberal arts college. And a liberal arts college fundamentally means that we are trying to reconnect modern Muslims with the arts, which traditionally referred to the quantitative and qualitative arts or disciplines, which are disciplines which are expected to help a person to become a lifelong learner. So in the Greek tradition, those disciplines were seven. Four of them we call the quadrivium. These are quantitative sciences, which were arithmetic, music, geometry, and astronomy. So arithmetic is the theory of number, and music was studied because it was called the application of number, or application of the theory of number. Geometry was a theory of space, and astronomy is the application of the theory of space. The other three disciplines we usually refer to as the qualitative sciences. We can say these are the sciences of meaning or of mind. The quadrivium, we call it the sciences of matter. These are things, because this is our world, number and space. And then the other three, they call the trivium, and the trivium means the place where three roads cross one another. Quadrivium means where four roads cross one another. So the trivium are grammar, logic, and rhetoric. And so these are very crucial sciences. They're tools that Muslims, if they master them before they study the other sciences we call the goal sciences, which are things like theology, which are things such as law and virtue ethics, among other things, tafsir, hadith. These are goal sciences that we study the tools in order to make it better for us to understand these other sciences, from which we extract direct benefit. And so at any rate, so we're trying to reestablish the connection between these because we see them deemed to be very crucial to the education of Muslims, making us very critical people, making us ask the right questions, helping us to articulate ourselves in the best way, helping us to think clearly about issues, you see, so that when we're challenged, we won't be easily persuaded or duped, among other things, inshallah. So I think we're ready to watch the video, and hopefully there's something. Is it slideshow or just video?
Video.
Okay, inshallah. Video and slideshow. Bismillah.
We're living in a time where people associate Boko Haram with Islam. We're living at a time when people don't think of Imam al-Ghazali or Fakhruddin al-Razi or all of these great giants that went before us. They think of ignorant people, and many people believe that this is Islam. And that's why we're here. That's what this is about. This is about restoring the centrality of knowledge to our religion. The centrality of knowledge to our religion.
Education doesn't just educate the intellect. No, education is a much more dynamic and holistic, integrative thing. It's an integrative process that helps to integrate the various parts. So if an education does not have anything to do with the spirit of the human being, if it has nothing to do with the psyche of the human being, then it's not, according to Mark Van Doren, really education. This course is to help them map the next 4 years of their education and to think really deeply about what it is that this whole Zaytuna curriculum does and will do, and what they will do with it.
This reading has me on the verge of tears, and it was after reading this quote, and it ties back into what it was that you had just said in reference to the works that we've been engaged in up until this point. They've challenged us, you know, spiritually, they've challenged us intellectually, they've challenged me in ways I've never been challenged before. But Mark Van Doren later on goes to say that the main thing is that there are powers within the person. Which liberal education, and only liberal education, can free for use. And, you know, this might not mean much to you guys, but it meant a lot to me. I've never really been able to tap into the side of me that this course and that this school has allowed me to tap into.
ذلك هو العنوان، عنوان جميل، زيتونة في الغرب، لكنها تحمل مضامين الفضيلة من الشرق، وتحمل مضمون العمل من الغرب أيضا.
وأصل القدر سر الله تعالى في خلقه. The essence, right, the foundation, the basis of the divine decree is God's secret within creation. This is Allah's secret. You know, how is it that I can choose on my own accord, but that's in perfect harmony and alignment with a pre-eternal decision, God's pre-eternal decision? It's a secret. It's Allah's secret, and we're not privy to it. We do not have access to that. But the mind has limits, and this is well beyond the limits of the human intellect. You have to do sajda with the qadr. Does that make sense? The mind has to make a sajda.
After taking theology 1 and theology 2, it makes complete sense why comparative religions is the third thing that you take. Because you have to theology 1 and theology 2 to gain a strong grounding in your own beliefs. And then taking that and running with it, and then studying like Hinduism and Confucianism and Jainism and Taoism and Christianity and Judaism, you really realize how similar a lot of them are, but how unique your own tradition is. I can look at these other traditions, I can take whatever wisdom I need, but at the same time be strong in my own faith.
Man is an angelic being. So let's say man is an angelic being. And you would say, no, it isn't. No, it isn't. No, no, it isn't. I say, yes, it is. Well, obviously, you're not going to solve that. You're not going to resolve that argument there on the street. But you will say, okay, no human being is an angelic creature. So what are you doing? You're saying, absolutely no member of the species man, right, is an angelic creature. So you're separating, absolutely separating, the predicate angelic creature from the concept man. So that means that man will be distributed, because in this particular proposition, when we say no man is an angelic being, we are taking man to stand for all of its individuals.
this whole idea of being a better person or a better individual or refining our souls, it's not just in Islam. It's in so many other traditions that came before, and I think because we're not exposed to it. And so I think it's amazing because that's where you get your philosophy class. That's where your philosophy class comes in. That's where your logic class comes in. All the Western tradition is so important because it's similar to our tradition. I think that's saying a lot, is that we don't just reject things that we don't know, because we don't know what could be in that is good for you.
So many questions I have about certain things, you know, Western philosophy doesn't have the answers to, but if you understand Aqidah, if you understand the Islamic scholarly tradition of theology, and you understand those arguments, then all of a sudden, some of those questions that were so perplexing before, now you have a clear answer. And it's not like it's a dogmatic answer, it actually makes sense rationally.
The most important and difficult thing is to continue to preserve the authenticity of your Islamic roots. And I do not mean only by that the daily prayers. That's very, very important, of course. I do not mean by that only Islamic ethics. That's also very, very important. But I mean by that also to preserve a mental ambience which is Islamic, in which the realities of Islam can be breathed.
If we don't have committed, knowledgeable, and fearless Muslim youth, we don't have Islam. We have some perversion of Islam. So this is the torchbearer here, Zaytuna. Let there rise among you, right? A group enjoining good and forbidding wrong. And let them start here. They start here in Zaytuna, and then they spread. So that's to me, the ultimate benefit of Zaytuna, is that it is a vehicle for sustaining the life of the human spirit.
Assalamu alaikum.
Oh, you can turn it back on. Halfway is fine, probably. My name is Shams. I'm with Zaytuna College. Thank you all very much for having us here and inviting us out here. We're pleased to be with you and proud to see the amazing school that you've built. Alhamdulillah. Inshallah, we'll have many future Zaytuna students coming from this community. Just a quick, brief history. Saad Abdullah covered it a little bit. Many of you have known us as Zaytuna Institute. We started in 1996, you know, built by volunteers. All of this is because of communities like yourself that have funded and supported physically, financially, and spiritually with your du'as, this project that we have going on in Berkeley, California. Pilot Seminary program started in 2004 with Imam Zay teaching all the classes. We started the college with our first convocation in 2010 with our class of 2014. We bought our first building in 2012 in Berkeley's Holy Hill. It's called Holy Hill, and many people ask the question oftentimes, you know, why didn't you make the school in Atlanta? Why didn't you make it in Chicago or New York, where there's so many Muslims? Why'd you make it all the way to the end of the earth in Berkeley, California? And one of the reasons, besides already having a lot of talent there in Berkeley, is we're on this amazing place called Holy Hill. And it is literally two blocks away from the University of California at Berkeley, which, if you look at any of the rankings and ratings, it's the top public school in the country, one of the top in the world. So we're literally two blocks away from there. In addition to that, we have this consortium of colleges all around us. We have the Graduate Theological Union, we have the Pacific School of Religion, we have the Church Divinity School, we have the Franciscan School of Theology, we have a couple of rabbinical schools, and there are many, many more around, and they are all literally mixed in with us, right next door to us. The two buildings buildings that we own, the first building and then the second one we bought in 2014, we actually bought from the Pacific School of Religion and the Franciscan School of Theology. And so there is a lot of collaboration going on, there's a lot of understanding going along, and there's a lot of benefit that we derive from being in an environment like that. For example, one of the best libraries in the country is at UC Berkeley, and our students have free access to it. Right, so that's a benefit that we have that we don't need to invest in, because alhamdulillah we have a good relationship with them. Our first graduation, and as Saad Abdullah pointed out earlier, we have Sidi Mahdi Amin here, one of our graduates. We'll hear from him a little bit later about his experience at Zaytuna College, what brought him to Zaytuna, and then post Zaytuna as well. And then this is, we're coming up, actually we've come up on a year since we've been accredited. Alhamdulillah, we're accredited by the Western Association of Schools and Colleges, which is the same accrediting body that accredits universities like Stanford, UC Berkeley, Washington. It's a regional system in higher education, so we have the highest degree of accreditation that we can have. Alhamdulillah, we did that in 13 months. It set a record for accreditation in the country. From application to accreditation, we did it in 13 months. And if you talk to folks in the higher education system that know about accreditation, this is truly a miracle from Allah, and that's why it was able to happen. A lot of this, Saad Abdullah talked about in his intro to Zaytuna, where about our curriculum and how we focus on the liberal arts and the traditional sciences as well. Just want to point out, you know, many of you know Zaytuna as Imam Zayd Shakir, Sheikh Hamza Yusuf, and Dr. Hatem Bazian, and that's why we're here. We want to tell you about the story behind Zaytuna College. You saw many of the other faculty members in the video. You've heard from Ustad Abdullah Ali here tonight, and we have many other faculty members at Zaytuna College that are all very, very, very highly educated and highly respected in their fields, coming from universities like Yale and Stanford, UC Berkeley, Notre Dame, and the list goes on and on and on. This is a close-up of the building that we first purchased. We'd love for you all to come visit, but we can't take you all there right now, so we thought, what was that? Yeah, so we have a virtual tour on our website. We'd encourage you to check that out, but in short of that, we'd like to just show you a quick snapshot of what Zaytuna College looks like. I know a lot of times we get questions from people asking, you know, what is it? Is it just like a madrasa? You guys sitting on the floor reading Quran? It's a hifz school. I think by now you've come to realize that that's not what it is. It's an actual Bachelor of Arts degree, and it's real classrooms and real offices, and it's a real college and a real campus, alhamdulillah. This building actually used to be a church. It was one of the first churches built in Berkeley. A neat story about this building is many, many years ago, before the concept of Zaytuna College was ever around, Sheikh Hamza was invited to give a lecture in this church. And as he was leaving, he said, wow, inshallah, Zaytuna will have a building like this one day. Not knowing that the college was coming, not knowing that we would buy that exact building that he was standing in at that time. It's the second building that we purchased a few years ago. It was home to, it was actually built as a Jewish fraternity back in the 1930s about. And the Franciscan School of Theology then bought it from them, and now the Muslims have acquired it. So as Imam Zayd likes to joke, it's correctly following the Abrahamic faith. And this building, inshallah, it was a huge acquisition for us, because this we have residential facilities that we lease from people, and for the brothers and the sisters, and this allows us to, inshallah, house our female students that we have. So we'll be able to house 30 plus female students in this, and it's literally four doors down from where we are, from where the first building is. And it allows us to have office space and faculty offices and whatnot, a classrooms as well, event space. There is some renovation that needs to be done to this building that the city is requiring us to do. It's things like HVAC and ADA compliance and stuff, because it is a much older building. There's some renderings of what the residence hall rooms, inshallah, will look like with the renovation being done. And some pictures of what the building looks like in its current state. Now, this renovation, inshallah, will cost us about $1.5 million. It sounds like a lot of money. It is a lot of money. It's California, so everything's a little more expensive. But the good news is that $1.5 million, once it's all said and done, will actually save Zaytuna College about $500,000 a year in operating costs and rental space. So as an investment, it's a very good payoff, and inshallah, within 3 years, it will pay for itself. You see on the left there, that's the first building that we bought, LeConte, and just four doors down is Euclid, the second building that we have. So a little bit about our students. Keep in mind, we're in our sixth year of operation. We've only been accredited for 1 year. And this is some data I pulled about our admitted class profile coming in for the fall of 2016. That's ranked up against collegedata.com's report of what Stanford and Emory have right now. So as you can tell, with our students coming in with their GPA, average ACT, and average SAT, and how they stack up against Stanford and Emory, the caliber of students that we're bringing into Zaytuna College. They're top-notch, they're very, very, very motivated students, and they really want to learn, and they really want to have an impact in this country and in the world, inshallah. And this is what we can do with our limited resources. This is what we can do with only being around for 6 years and only 1 year of accreditation. So imagine with your support, imagine with your du'as, what Zaytuna College can do and the type of leaders that Zaytuna College can produce. These are just some shots in the classroom, and if you look in the front row, that head should seem a little familiar to you. That's Mehdi while he was a student at Zaytuna. This is Dr. Yusuf Ismail teaching the astronomy, or is that the mathematics course. Our students engage, and they have a requirement for community service that they do every year. This is them in doing some Habitat for Humanity work. They do a lot of outdoor work and outdoor experiential projects. This is with Imam Dawood Yassin, one of our faculty members as well. I think this was, they were in Yosemite or something, doing some work out there. At that point, we actively encourage our students to take up extracurricular activities. One of those activities that we have is an archery club, and there's one of our students practicing with her bow and arrow. Just an example of some of the impact that our graduates are already having. One of our graduates in the first class, one of Mehdi's students, peers, is Fatima Knight, who you see in the bottom right picture on the right side. She's sitting with President Obama there at the White House Iftar this past Ramadan. She's done a lot of work in the interfaith realm. She's done a lot of work and a lot of writing, actually, that's been picked up by some top publications and top schools. But one of the things that we wanted to highlight was the impact that it's having in the immediate realm of current events. You know, you guys remember in South Carolina there were many churches that were burned down recently as part of a racist act. So here comes a Muslim student, graduate of Zaytuna College, sets up a small little a crowdfunding page that raises hundreds of thousands of dollars. It goes viral, it gets picked up by Huffington Post, gets picked up by Mashable, gets picked up by a whole bunch of websites and blogs, and it shows you the impact that Zaytuna College students and graduates are having right here, right now. And again, just being a year out of graduation. Zaytuna again coming in the spotlight right after San Bernardino. LA Times came up, they drove up, and they did a multiple day story on our students. They spent about 3 days on campus talking to our students, talking to our faculty about what it means to be a young Muslim in the United States today in this environment of Islamophobia. So they're spreading light on the fact that there are Muslims doing good, and there are Muslims that are productive members of society. And before we get into some of the numbers, I'd like to invite Mehdi up here to give his experience on Zaytuna College and give us a few words of wisdom.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa barak ala Sayyidina Muhammad. I'm one of the lucky ones because all you guys donate and then I benefit as a student. Supposed to laugh, wasn't funny? No? Alhamdulillah, I feel at home here because Ms. Farhat Siddiqui was actually the principal of the high school that I graduated from in Chicago. And the school that I'm a part of in California is called Elim Tree. So I feel very much at home here. So thank you guys for welcoming us very much. Alhamdulillah, I'm very blessed to be a graduate of Zaytuna College. I grew up, born and raised in Chicago, and I graduated college. I was 19 years old in political science and economics, and then I went to law school, and I practiced as a lawyer for 7 years, and I was working as corporate counsel for Dell Corporation. So if you had a Dell computer, I may have worked on a relevant contract. And then, one day I prayed Friday prayer, and then I was like, for some reason, right after Friday prayer, I was like, Zaytuna College, oh my God. So I got up and prayed istikhara right there. And then I went home and I applied, and on Monday I submitted my application. And then in a week I had an interview and I was accepted. And then I told my wife. Alhamdulillah, she was very supportive. And then we moved up, alhamdulillah, and I studied there and graduated. What's so special about it is that what's unique about Zaytuna College is that it made it accessible. Accessible. It changed my life, it changed my family's life, and changed so many other people's lives, inshallah, bi'idhnillah. Because it's accessible. It's in the US, it's in America, and it combines Eastern and Western traditions. Right? So you can graduate from Zaytuna, you can go to law school, you can go to humanities, you can go to master's, you can go to a PhD program. You can do all these things, and it's accredited. So it's accessible. It's accessible. There's nothing like this out there in the entire United States or in the Western Hemisphere. It makes it accessible. My experience there was it was exceptional. It's mind, body, and soul. It nourishes your mind, nourishes your body, and nourishes your soul. But really, my brothers and sisters, I wanna understand the context of Zaytuna College. Why is Zaytuna College the most important project, Muslim American project of our time? I contend that it is the most important Muslim American project of our time, and it's unlike any other project. And it's because right now, my brothers and sisters, as you are aware, we're sick. Our community, we're in a global crisis. We're in a global crisis. And our community is sick. Why? Because we know, just like ourselves, we have a mind, body, and soul. We have the lower selves and the desires. And if the desires overcome and the intellect doesn't control and doesn't restrain, what does aql come from? Aql comes from to restrain. It's a hobbling cord. It's a rope that they put around a camel so the camel doesn't run away. That's what aql is. It restrains and holds something so it doesn't run away. So we have aql, intellect, so our desires don't run away. So our appetite doesn't run away. So our anger doesn't run away, and it restrains it. But where is the aql of our community? Of the Muslim ummah, of the Muslim community? We have to restore that. We have to restore the aql of our community so that we don't stay ill, so that we can resolve this crisis. What are all these, excuse my language, wackos and nutheads doing around the world? They're sick because the aql is not there and doesn't restrain it. Because it may start somewhere, but if I put a line from here now to downtown Atlanta and I move it just one inch, I'm going to miss Atlanta. I'm going to miss Atlanta by the time it gets there. Right? But we need the aql to restore, and that's why you see right here, keyword, restoring the centrality of knowledge to our religion. The aql, the knowledge, is the medicine that we need. Imagine a house without a parent. Imagine a hospital without doctors. Imagine people building a bridge without engineers. Imagine a community without scholars.
It doesn't work. The house will be in anarchy. The hospital will be in amiss. The bridge, people will break and will fall. And that's what we're experiencing today. And so if we want to do something and be a part of the solution to the problems of the Muslim Ummah in the world, it is, Zaytuna College is part of that solution. Why? Because Zaytuna College is a feeder. It's a feeder organization. So someone might graduate from there one day and come teach here. And they'll teach you the balanced Islam. Islam, Iman, Ihsan. With understanding of both the East and the West. They're not going to come, they're going to be relevant. Ta'seel and tawseel. They're going to be connected to the text, our history and our tradition, and they're going to be connected to the context of American values. Can you put up the first slide, the mission statement? We don't want people who just memorize the entire Quran and can't connect to our youth. And so our youth memorize the whole Quran and then they go to college and then they become atheists. And we don't want people to be so progressive that they throw away 1,000 years of scholarship so that they can connect and be so cool and funny and say, oh, you don't need to do this and you don't need to do that. Let's be modern. Let's be modern, right? We need text and context, ta'seel and tawseel. And Zaytuna College is your institution. It's not Berkeley's. It's not California's. We are all in this ship that's sinking. We are all in this flood in this world, and Zaytuna College is a ship. And it's your ship, and you're on it, and your children are on it, whether you recognize it or not. Whether we want to believe it or not, we are on this ship, and Zaytuna College is one of these ships. And may there be 100 Zaytuna Colleges. Ameen. Everyone say Ameen. But we need more. We need the knowledge focused, right? We need the knowledge return. Look at this mission statement. Look at how balanced and holistic it is. Zaytuna College aims to educate and prepare what? Morally, professional, intellectual, spiritual, okay? All four categories. Grounded in what? Grounded in what? Islamic scholarly tradition and conversant with cultural currents, right? And there, I'm serious. If we don't let our organization, Zaytuna College, succeed, our whole ship is gonna fall. Like, if this doesn't succeed, then I don't know what will. There's no better attempt right now than the aggregation of the scholars. Ustaz Abdullah, the only U.S., the first graduate from Qadawiyyin University. One of our professors was a graduate from Yale University, tenured track professor at Notre Dame, left it. Sheikh Hamza Yusuf, Imam Zaid Shakir, and so many others. And if this doesn't succeed, this is all our project. This is our baby. This is our baby. And we need 12,000, supporters. You know what a waqf is? A waqf, an endowment. Waqf. In our Islamic history, we had waqf, awqaf, endowments that took care of everything. We had so many endowments, we didn't know what to make endowments for. That we're like, what do we make endowments for? Oh, let's make it for these old animals that are dying. So we had a waqf for old animals that were dying, to take care of them in a noble, beautiful way. Because everything in Islam, if it lacks beauty, it lacks Islam. If it lacks mercy, it lacks Islam. And even, so we had an endowment to take care of old animals. Land and money so they can be fed properly. We had a waqf, an endowment, to give money to who? To servants that made a mistake so they don't get punished by their master. We had so many waqf, but do we have awqaf right now? No. You are the waqf. We need 12,000 monthly supporters. And then we're done. And then our scholars can actually teach instead of fundraise. Do we want doctors that are sitting there and scrubbing the floor of the surgery room? No, it doesn't make sense, but our scholars are so busy fundraising that they can't do scholarly things and teach. So we need to do our part. I want to be a pawn on the chessboard. I'm not a king, I'm not a queen, I'm not a bishop, I'm not a rook. I'm just a pawn, but let me be a pawn with a smile. Let me embrace my role and let our scholars do their scholarly work. And let me just be a pawn. Whatever I want to do, let me give a monthly donation.
You know, there's called a conversion rate in marketing. In marketing, how many people did you convert? So we have 100 people here. Maybe we'll convert 2%, two people will become monthly donors. Maybe we'll convert 3%, three people will become monthly donors. You know, maybe we'll convert 50% and 50 people will become monthly donors. Be one of those that convert. Be a convert to Islam. All the Sahaba were converts. All the Sahaba were converts, right? They all converted to Islam, to Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So, forgive me, but you know, I work right now, I continue to practice law for a global pharmaceutical, for a global cancer research laboratory, and I work at Ta'lif Collective. It's a convert continuum of care organization. We help converts. So every day we help converts on a regular basis. I teach at Alim Tree, not Alim Academy. Alhamdulillah, I'm a part of this interfaith program where we go and present. But this is all because of Zaytuna College. I used to have, alhamdulillah, a blessing, 8-to-5 job practicing law. Now I can do both because of the blessings of Zaytuna College. So I love you all as my brothers and sisters, my aunts and uncles, my sisters, my younger brothers. May Allah bless you all. I'm going to pass the torch back to Shams. And I encourage you all to not leave until you become a monthly donor. $500 a month, $1 a month. Just do it. Just fill it out and forget it. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
JazakAllah khair, Mehdi. Thank you all very much for your time. Before we leave you here tonight, as we don't want to take up too much of it, we know Isha's coming in soon. Just that we're not here to shake you down tonight. Inshallah, we'll do that on April 9th in downtown Atlanta when we have Sheikh Hamza as our keynote speaker, which we invite you all to come to. But just an idea of what it costs to put one of our students, to attract one of those students that we showed earlier on the slide that are beating out the standards of Stanford and Emory and all the other great schools out there. Many of the students that we have in the beginning, many students like Mehdi could have gone and done many other things. Others had scholarships to University of Chicago, to many of other prestigious institutions. And so we want to be able to attract those students to Zaytuna College. We want to be able to say, okay, you know what, Emory gave you a scholarship, Mercer gave you a scholarship, Chicago gave you a scholarship, Columbia gave you a scholarship, well, we're going to give you a scholarship. We want you to come to Zaytuna College. And inshallah, I understand over the next 4 years, you're going to build out your high school. Inshallah, you can talk about creating a scholarship within your own community to send your students is Zaytuna College. From what I understand, the tuition, alhamdulillah, you guys have set at your school, many people can afford it, but maybe perhaps people can't afford this, right? And we want to entice our students to pursue a path of education at Zaytuna College. Two quick things we left out. We have a commitment, alhamdulillah, we've been able to stick with it, and inshallah, with your help, we'll be able to. No student has ever graduated Zaytuna College with even a dime of debt. And we will plan on continuing that. And we've been able to do that because of generous donors. And number two, you've heard, you know, students can go into law school, students could go do PhDs and stuff. You're probably asking, you know, we have a STEAM curriculum here. Alhamdulillah, I think you've been convinced we've got covered. What about the S, T, E, and M? Well, with our close relationship with UC Berkeley, they have invited our students to come and take STEM classes at UC Berkeley. You know, we don't have organic chemistry labs, we don't have physics labs, we don't have anatomy labs. UC Berkeley has some of the top ones in the world. So they've allowed our students to come in and take the classes, and obviously they get credit there. So if they wanted to go to medical school, if they wanted to go into engineering, if they wanted to do computer science, it's a little extra work, but it's all doable within 4 years. We have that coursework mapped out for the students. So not only are you getting students trained in the traditional liberal arts from top quality faculty, as well as in the Islamic sciences, but you're getting students who are top trained by the top minds in the STEM fields as well. And as Mehdi was saying, here's some of the kind of virtual endowment type of activities that help keep Zaytuna College going. And last but not least, please join us Saturday, April 9th at the CNN Omni Center Hotel in downtown Atlanta. We'll have Sheikh Hamza Yusuf as well as some other faculty members and staff from Zaytuna College. We'd love to tell you a little bit more about Zaytuna, hear what our future plans are, and give you the opportunity to support this great project that we have going on in Berkeley. JazakAllah khair.
Allahumma salli love. Any questions or anything?
Jazakumullah khair, Sheikh Hamid, to come out and the Zaytuna team to present this. So if you guys have any more questions, you guys will be available at the table outside. Also, we have an Ilm Academy table outside, which we are talking about our own fundraising later on in April. So inshallah, stop by. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
I just want to say this, just to be clear. Alhamdulillah, Zaytuna, Mahdi is very passionate about how he feels about Zaytuna, and I'm sure he didn't mean to belittle any other projects. Right, so just this is how he's expressing how he feels about Zaytuna. And so there are many projects out there, they're worthy causes as well, you know, so we want to make sure that we're clear about that, you know, so we definitely hope to get your support to help us continue to do what we're doing, inshallah, and hopefully expand. Jazakumullah khair. May Allah give you success.
Sheikh Migdal.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما ربنا اجعلنا مقيم الصلاة ومن ذرياتنا ربنا وتقبل الدعاء ربنا اغفر لنا ولوالدينا وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب ربنا أنزلنا منزلا مباركا وأنت خير المنزلين مع الذين أنعمت عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون والسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين آمين آمين آمين.